Good morning. Welcome to the Grand Rounds, CNCL. Today we have Dr. Saifi Baidwal from Arvind Eye Hospital visiting CMC Ludhiana. And she would be presenting the Grand Rounds. But before she starts her presentation, I request Dr. Rupali to please introduce the speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. A very good morning to everyone. Eyes are a window to the world, but some people are not as fortunate as us to be able to see through this window. The ophthalmology fraternity celebrates this National Eye Donation Fortnight every year from 25th of August to 8th September. So it's basically a campaign to create a mass public awareness about eye donation. And also it's a time for us to remember, thank, honor the family members of the donors, give us a precious gift of sight to someone. So the topic of today's Grand Rounds was chosen to commemorate this event. Now there are more than 10 million people who are suffering from corneal blindness in our country. And the only ray of hope for them is a corneal transplant. But now there's a huge gap between the demand and supply for this eye donation. And unfortunately, like most other transplant surgeries, corneal transplantation surgeries also took a major hit during these COVID times. The guidelines for tissue retrieval were made very stringent, and that led to very few eye donations and hence a significant increase in the backlog of our corneal blindness. So that is the topic for today's Grand Rounds. Our speaker for today is Dr. Shafi Badwal. Now, Dr. Shafi has undergone extensive training in cornea and refractive surgery at the prestigious Arvind Eye Institute. We are fortunate to have her as our visiting faculty at CMC, and she has also successfully performed corneal transplantation surgeries at CMC. So now I request Dr. Shafi to please present her talk for today.
Good morning, everyone. Screen sharing. Is the screen visible?
We can see your slides.
Your screen is not visible yet.
Okay, just a second. It's not. It's still not sharing.
Shafi, we can see your screen now, but it needs to be a full screen.
Is it visible now?
Yes.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Sorry for the hitch. It's an honor to present for the Grand Rounds, especially on the Eye Donation Fortnight, which we celebrate every year. So I'll start with a brief of what is cornea. We all know it's the outermost transparent tissue of the eye, thickness of which is equal to a credit card, and it is kept moist and nourished by a thin layer of tears. The blinking of the eyes keeps the cornea smooth and well nourished. So the cornea has five layers, from outer to inner. This is epithelium, Bowman's membrane, stroma, Desmond's membrane, and endothelium. normally the cornea is clear, but if the cornea becomes distorted, scarred or opaque, then the light rays passing through it are distorted and the vision is reduced. On such cases, a cornea transplant may be necessary to replace the diseased or injured cornea with a healthy, clear cornea to restore good vision. Some of the causes of corneal blindness are corneal ulceration, corneal trauma, trachoma, vitamin A deficiency, hereditary problems, and congenital diseases. Now, coming to the magnitude of blindness, worldwide, there are 37 million people blind, and to this number, 1 to 2 million is added every year. Southeast Asia only has 33% of the world's blind population, with 50% of the world's childhood blindness. In India, the number is estimated at 14 to 15 million, and 3 lakh Indian children are blind. In addition, an estimated 9.2 million children are functionally blind due to visual impairment, which can be due to any cause. The corneal blindness is estimated at approximate of 6.8 million people who have vision less than 6/60 in at least one eye due to corneal diseases. Out of a global population of 37 million blind people, 15 million belong to India, and 75% of these cases are avoidable blindness, thus shining a light on the importance of the eye donation fortnight, which is celebrated every year from 25th August to 8th September. This is a campaign which aims to create mass public awareness about the importance of eye donation and to motivate people to pledge their eyes for donation after death. In this, the damaged cornea is replaced with a healthy donor cornea, which is known as the graft. This process is known as keratoplasty or corneal grafting. The history of tissue transplantation starts from Adam and Eve in Eden. Throughout history, however, the eye as the avenue to the sun god, virtue and wisdom, with blindness as a penalty for impiety and the stigma of sexual shame. Blind people were generally regarded as social outcasts for whom treatment of any sort represented a tampering with God's proper judgment. In myths and folklore, although occasionally the damaged eye was replaced by the fresh one, the eye is more usually replaced by its symbolic equivalent of wisdom or second sight. Now, the surgical removal of the diseased cornea and replacing it with a healthy donor tissue is known as keratoplasty, as told before. Now, this can be of basically two types. If we transplant the full thickness corneal tissue with a healthy donor graft, that is known as penetrating keratoplasty. In lamellar keratoplasty, only the diseased portion of the compromised cornea is removed, whereas the healthy structures remain. This can be further divided into the anterior or the posterior lamellar keratoplasty. Some of the common indications is the optical keratoplasty, which is done to restore corneal transparency and normal vision. There is no infectious cause. Some of the reasons are aphakic and pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, corneal opacities following infectious keratitis, trauma, graft failure, endothelial and stromal corneal dystrophies, corneal degenerations, congenital corneal opacities, and keratoconus. Tectonic or reconstitutive keratoplasty is done to restore the altered corneal structure, like in corneal ectasia, corneal perforation or loss of corneal tissue, keratoconus and keratoglobus, PMD, corneal melting associated with any autoimmune diseases, corneal fistula, or post-traumatic loss of corneal tissue. Therapeutic keratoplasty is done to eliminate infectious load in the eyes with infectious keratitis unresponsive to antimicrobial therapy. It is common in fungal or acanthamoeba keratitis. It also is done for reducing the pain of bullous keratopathy or to visualize the fundus in cases we need to perform retinal procedures like pars plana vitrectomy. Cosmetic keratoplasty is done to remove unsightly scar and to improve the appearance of the eye. This has nothing to do with any visual performance. Coming to the preoperative evaluation of the recipient who has to undergo a cornea transplant, the ocular history, we look for any ocular injury, presence of any infection or any nutritional deficiency, previous ocular surgery or any systemic conditions like collagen vascular diseases or Stevens-Johnson syndrome. General history includes history of any cardiac or pulmonary disorder, hypertension, diabetes, use of antiplatelets, tuberculosis, etc. Visual acuity recording includes both uncorrected visual acuity as well as best corrected visual acuity. Gross ocular examination, we need to look out for the lids to rule out any ectropion, entropion, lag of thalamus, trichiasis or blepharitis, any tear film abnormalities, and lacrimal function to rule out any dacrocystitis. Slit lamp biomicroscopy includes examination of conjunctiva and cornea. Simplifron, corneal opacity, we need to grade what is the size, shape, and extent, and thus plan the surgery accordingly. Vascularization and corneal sensation. Anterior segment findings, we need to look for active inflammation, any rubiosis or synechiae. In the lens, we need to look out for presence of cataract, aphakia, pseudophakia, weak zonules, or any presence of phacodonosis. Intraocular pressure has to be recorded before surgery. And fundus examination to look out for macular or retinal pathology so that this gives idea of the prognosis of the surgery. Investigations include refraction, tear film status, keratometry, gonioscopy, pachymetry, specular or confocal microscopy, Schlemmer imaging, and ultrasonography of the posterior segment. All these factors determine the prognosis of the surgery. Some of the recipient prognostic factors, these can be divided into four categories. The category one holds excellent prognosis. Cases which fall into this category are keratoconus, lattice dystrophy, and granular dystrophy. Category two has very good prognosis with cases like pseudophakic bullous keratopathy, aphakic bullous keratopathy, or Fuchs dystrophy. Third category with fair prognosis includes keratoglobus, PMD, corneal opacities in the pediatric group, mild chemical injury cases, and mild dry eye cases. The poor prognosis category include ocular pemphigoid, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, neuroparalytic or neurotrophic diseases, and multiple graft failure. This is a picture depicting the replacement of a diseased cornea with a healthy donor tissue. Another picture depicting a simpler version, the cloudy cornea, where the cornea is removed from the center and the graft is placed with the sutures. A knife called trephine is used to cut and remove a circular piece from the recipient's scarred cornea. A similar knife is used to cut and remove a piece from the donor cornea. The donor cornea is then placed where the recipient's cornea was removed. It is sewn into place with very fine sutures, which are smaller in diameter even than a human hair. I'll share a small video showing the process of keratoplasty. This is the donor cornea being prepared with the trephine. 8 mm trephine is used here. The scleral rim is removed and the central cornea is preserved. Now, this is the recipient bed being prepared. The trephine is used, the host trephine 7.75 mm is used. The donor cornea cut is 0.25 to 0.5 mm bigger than the recipient trephination. This after doing the partial trephination, visco dissection is done and we use the scissors to cut the central cornea. This is the patient who has bonus that is clearer. After the button is the host cornea is cut fully with the scissors. This is the donor button we prepared. It's placed and secured with 10-0 nylon sutures. These are very fine sutures. Everything is done under microscope. The cornea is secured first with 4 cardinal sutures and then in between we place the other sutures. So these are the 4 cardinal sutures placed. After then in between we place other and total of 16 sutures. So India needs 2.5 lakh donated eyes every year and we are able to meet a low number of 25,000 from the 109 eye banks in the country and only a number of 10,000 corneal transplants are being done every year due to the shortage. What is eye donation? It is an act of donating one's eyes after his or her death, and it is purely for the benefit of the society. It is voluntary, and only corneal people, blind people, are benefited from the donated eyes. Eye banks provide the donor cornea, which in turn obtain it from deceased people who have pledged their eyes or whose family have given the permission for donation. Normally, the cornea does not have any blood vessels. That is why there are very little chances of failure of cornea transplants because the body does not recognize that it's a foreign cornea. Race, sex, blood type, eye color, or the glasses number does not, they are not considered for selecting the donor because they do not affect the outcome of the cornea transplant surgery. Unlike the other transplants where blood group typing and other things are to be considered. So it's an organ donor and deciding to help someone after your death is a great deed. It helps people regain their certain functions such as vision. By donating one's eyes posthumously, a corneal blind person regains their ability to see through a surgical procedure, which have been discussed earlier. Some of the barriers to collection of donor eyes are inadequate public awareness, insufficient facilities in the institutes and hospitals, absence of motivation even among the trained personnel in hospitals also, and some religious myths. So coming to some of the myths which are roaming around, everybody has these myths. Everybody asks such things that people think eyes can be removed out of living human beings. No, they can be removed only after a person's death. People believe that it causes disfigurement of the face, which is not true. After removing the eyeballs, we put a gauge inside the orbital place and then the lid is sutured. So it does not cause any face disfigurement. Eye donation interferes with or delays customary final rites. This also does not hold true, because if the whole procedure takes about only 15 to 20 minutes and it can be done anywhere. Also, people think cornea transplantation is an experimental procedure. No, it is a proven, routinely performed surgery and is a very successful procedure. We have so many patients who are happily living their life just because somebody donated and they can see through it. People also think that Indian eyes are not good to be used. No, eyes of any person anywhere in the world can be used, but only after evaluation we use the eyes. People also think that the entire can be transplanted, entire eye can be transplanted. No, only the cornea, the front part of the eye can be used for transplantation. The other part like retina or the other parts cannot be used. Selling or buying of human eyes is also illegal. And it's not that if you have not pledged your eyes, then you cannot donate. No, even if a person has pledged their eyes, the consent of the family members is very essential, without which an eye cannot be removed. All donor eyes are acceptable, irrespective of age and sex. And it's a very common myth that if we donate the eye, then we'll be blind in next birth. No. It's an act of charity that is bound to earn blessings. So we need to have eye donation awareness activities to rule out all those myths and to make people aware of the advantages of donating the eyes. Eye donation has to be encouraged among everybody. And then only cornea transplantation can be done. So an eye bank is a charitable organization without any profit motive. It facilitates the removal, processing, and evaluation of the eyes. It and distributes them to persons in need of eye transplant. This is the eye pledge form. Whoever wants to donate, they can pledge through this form. And we have a 24 hours helpline in the eye bank. So any queries, any donation or anything can be for any, if anybody wants to donate whenever, they can call on this helpline and solve their queries, or anybody who wants to donate, they can call on this number and the team will come to collect the eyeball. So as discussed, anybody can donate the eyeball irrespective of age, sex, and blood group. Patients with history of hypertension, diabetes, asthma, active tuberculosis, old history of tuberculosis can also. Spectacle wearers and people who have undergone cataract surgery in the past can also donate their eyes, and there is no age limit for donation. But there are definitely some contraindications. In these cases, we do not take the eyeball, like people with infectious diseases, AIDS, HIV positive patient, encephalitis, endocarditis, active hepatitis, active tuberculosis, syphilis, leprosy, malaria, or congenital rubella. Septicemia patients who had septicemia and have died, in that cases also, we do not take the donor. We do not take the eyeball. People with malignancy like Hodgkin's disease, leukemia, and lymphoma. With neurological disorders like CJD, GBS, motor neuron diseases, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's, or Parkinson's. And also neurodegenerative, the death with neurological disease of unknown diagnosis or dementia. Coming to eye disorders, which are considered contraindication. They include any active ocular or intraocular infection at the time of death, like endophthalmitis or keratitis, conjunctivitis, presence of any malignant tumors, corneal disorders like keratoconus or keratoglobus, any corneal opacity, which involves the central area, and patients who have undergone corneal surgery like radial keratectomy or LASIK surgery. The LASIK surgery is, in fact, it does not exclude us from doing an endothelial keratoplasty. So this is a partial contraindication. We cannot do a full thickness graft, but definitely we can do a posterior lamellar keratoplasty in such cases. So the surgical retrieval, we can do enucleate, where we take the whole eye. We can do in situ excision or just a corneal scleral rim. And it can be performed either in the operating room, a morgue, a funeral room, or even in the hospital room also. This is the enucleation procedure, where first we drape the eye, the muscles are cut from their insertions. Then the eyeball is separated and the optic nerve is cut. Then the eyeball is placed in a sterile container and thus placed finally in a container with box and eyes to be transported to the eye bank. Some of the instructions for the relatives, or when you have decided that you need to donate the eye, you have called the eye bank. So just switch off the fans so that it does not cause any dryness. Raise the head of the disease by about 6 inches if possible. Ensure that the eyelids are properly shut and place a clean wet cloth over the eyelids. Do not put any religious material over the eyes or face of the disease. Inform the eye bank team as soon as possible. And if possible, keep a copy of the death certificate. After donation, they receive a certificate, and only the ones deemed suitable are used for transplantation. Other are used for research and education. Recipients who are on the list will be notified on a first-come, first-served basis from the registry. So how do we store the donor cornea? So it's either a short-term storage, a medium, or a long-term storage. The moist chamber storage, we place the enucleated eye in a sealed chamber with gauze, which is moistened with saline or antimicrobial solution. The storage in this medium is only for 24 hours and we need to use it within that time. The hypothermic corneal storage is the most commonly used. It's either MK medium. We store it at 4 degrees Celsius, and the storage can vary from 2 to 3 days up to 7 to 10 days. And the normothermic storage, it is incubated in nutrient media at physiological temperature, and it can be stored for 30 days. But this method is more complex and requires technical expertise. So this is not used much. Now the COVID-19 pandemic, it has definitely affected people all around the world and the medical fraternity in particular. The cornea specialty and the eye banking fraternity had its own unique set of challenges that required several modifications and updated guidelines in the practice patterns from what existed in the pre-COVID-19 era. So some of the guidelines which were laid by the eye bank societies and the corneal societies, the All India Society, they held meetings and they came up with certain guidelines how to you collect the tissues and do cornea transplant in this COVID area so that the virus is not transmitted to the recipient. So all the collected tissues which we collect, they are quarantined for 48 hours prior to release of the tissue for usage of cornea transplant. The eye banking activities to be resumed through cornea retrieval program. there is no voluntary or community donation in eye collection. Only hospital retrieval is allowed. No eye banking activities in containment zones, and the recovery technician or doctor has to use full PP kits, which includes N95 mask, cap, face shield, gloves, gown, while recovering the donor tissue. Exclusions for donation: persons who have tested positive for or diagnosed with COVID-19, people with acute respiratory illness or fever, any of the symptoms. These guidelines keep on changing. The COVID-19 symptoms keep on changing. So any symptom we feel is linked to COVID-19, such people are not allowed to donate. Individuals who have been exposed to a confirmed or suspected COVID-19 patients within the last 14 days, any evidence of conjunctivitis or ARDS, pneumonia, or CT report showing any ground glass opacities. So these were exclusions from the donor, from donating the eyes. Now coming to precautions for the cornea transplant procedure. Cornea transplants can be elective or emergency. So for elective, tested via PCR testing before undergoing surgery, and should be confirmed PCR negative, and they should be in self-isolation from testing until the time of surgery. Any positive recipients would not be eligible for elective corneal transplants, and they should be taken off the donor waiting list until 2 consecutive nose and throat RT-PCR swab tests are negative and they are symptom-free. So the emergency cornea transplants, the recipients again should be tested via RT-PCR testing before the surgery. For positive patients who have to undergo surgery as it is emergency, all the staff should be protected with full PPE kits and N95 masks. The recipient eye disinfection has to be done with povidone iodine. So say yes to eye donation. It definitely will make a difference in the life of 2 people by giving them sight. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shefali, for that excellent presentation. I have a few questions for you, and I'm sure participants also would have. See, why are you harvesting the entire globe when you only need the cornea, and cornea doesn't have a blood vessel, blood supply, and all those things you said? So I know that socket, eye socket also, I mean that, you know, the orbit also won't look empty. You're just removing the cornea, hardly anybody would notice it.
Good question, but there are first lots of vitreous, everything definitely will come out. So when we suture that, so it is not going to be as same as that. Obviously, we will have to close the lids also for that, because that is also is not going to be visually very nice. Plus, sclera is also useful for us. For any glaucoma surgeries or patients who have scleral thinning due to autoimmune diseases, we can keep that sclera in glycerol and then use it further in other cases. Also, the sclera rim, sometimes in patients who have infectious keratitis, we need to have a large graft. So if we have a whole eyeball, it is easy to, you know, take out the button and cut it in the eye bank accordingly, whatever we want.
Okay, right. And then the second thing is, you said there's a huge mismatch between the, you know, cornea that is available for transplantation and the requirement, you know, actual patients needing cornea there. So what is your society doing for, yes, you know, generating, yes, awareness? One, to training the, you know, the new surgeons so that it is available everywhere without any, you know, itches. So what is the society doing, your ophthalmology society?
First of all, this eye donation fortnight, which we are conducting every year from 25th August to 8th September, it's a campaign where we highlight through mass rallies and everywhere that obviously we need to have an awareness. Then everywhere in the hospitals, the staff is trained so that they are made aware that there is a transplant available, so that they can encourage other people. We have online activities. This, especially in this 2 weeks, we have lots of activities, the quiz, and throughout India, in fact, the world.
So that means, you know, we won't have any shortage soon with the way things are moving. That's very good. Dr. Jairaj, I can see your hands raised. Would you like to ask?
Yeah, so thank you. It was a very good talk and very informative for all of us. And so I was thinking about that consent process. You mentioned that the patient would have signed a consent and for donation. After the death, again we need to get from the relatives. So okay, legally, is it correct?
Yes, sir.
One has already agreed, to donate after the death, then why would the relatives, relatives' consent is needed?
So these are the norms, because we have so many myths, and obviously it's not only about a person, it's about a family. So it's like there have been issues in the past, so where the families did not consent, and going to a place for eye donation where the even if a person has pledged and the family is resenting that no situation. So that is why these.
Yeah. So is it India specific or globally also it's like that?
Globally, sir, globally. It's everywhere the same.
Oh, that is very strange, because overseas you have an advanced health directive. They decide what they need to do. Suppose somebody has written that I can't be put on ventilator when I develop some disease, and nobody can overrule. That is their right. So that's why I was surprised. You need to take another concern from the relatives. Yeah.
Okay.
If somebody has, even after death, if the family says no, then we cannot take the eyeball.
Yeah. It's open for questions. Anybody has anything to ask Dr. Shaif, you can ask.
I'm Dr. Varghese. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please ask.
Yeah. How many transplants are we doing in a year over here in CMC?
In CMC, we have started last year only, and around we have done till now around 7-8 transplants till now.
Okay. Thank you.
So we are picking up. We are picking up right now. So
yeah. Let that progress. We need all the best.
The support from everybody from the hospital. Thank you, sir. We definitely need a support from the hospital staff everywhere in the ICU, so that they can counsel people for eye donation. We have an eye bank. We can collect hospital donations everywhere, but we need support, a combined effort.
So the training that is required for being a corneal transplant surgeon, how is that happening? Is it only a select few doing or you know somebody who is interested, how does the process start to become a cornea transplant surgeon?
Sorry, I didn't get it. Your network, I guess my network was not good.
How is the process of getting trained to become a cornea transplant surgeon? Like, you know, once you have finished your MS ophthalmology, what happens next?
Then it's up to us which people like to be a retina surgeon or a glaucoma specialist. I per se wanted to be a cornea specialist. So we undergo fellowships. I have done my fellowship from Arvind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore. So we are trained for a period of 1.5 years only in this department, cornea, going to eye banks, going to people's place for collecting eyes. It's up to us who we want people surgeries.
Hey, suppose a professor in a medical college wants to start a cornea transplant program. How does it go?
In medical colleges, it's easy. They just have to have all the facilities. And normally, earlier, even a general ophthalmologist also. But these days, guidelines have become a bit strict. So if you have a cornea transplant surgeon, a person who has done a particular fellowship only, then only that place is allowed to undergo cornea transplants. We need to take permission from the eye bank, the transplant, according to the Transplant Act. They do an inspection, see what facilities you have, and then only they give the permission to undergo cornea transplant. Without that, we cannot do.
Okay. Dr. Pamela, I can see you. Raise your hand. Would you like to ask?
Yeah, a nice presentation. I just wanted to know, I don't know whether I missed out because of the internet issues. I just wanted to know, did you speak anything about the contraindications of corneal transplant? Like in a patient, I being from the oncology side, like patients with metastatic cancer, we won't be taking their cornea, right? Or is
Yes, definitely, ma'am. No, patients with leukemia and lymphomas, these are the contraindications. And in eye, retinoblastoma, these patients are contraindications.
So solid tumors is not a contraindication. Solid tumors.
Not in the eye, then.
Okay. Thank you.
Ashish.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Shafi, thank you for excellent presentation. Eye bank in our hospital is functional, and with the assistance of US board, we have upgraded. But in between, there was no one to perform surgeries. And it's good Dr. Shafi is with us for more than a year now. It's a second year in progress. And it's good. Even in COVID time, you have done 6 to 7 surgeries. It's a great achievement. And I'm sure this year onwards, we have to launch a campaign with our students, staff. And I'm sure they are not aware of facilities which we have in our hospital. And I would encourage you to conduct sessions with our staff, ICUs and at other places, so they can avail this facility. How do you get list of donors where you have to call them and decide on what basis transplant has to be done.
The list of donors or recipients?
Yeah. Who is informing you? Like recipients, you have to decide who is the suitable candidate to receive the next cornea whenever it is available. Must be a difficult task,
sir,
or the society is deciding.
No, sir. The hospital based. So we have a cornea transplant register where people who come in the OPDs, and we counsel them, whoever has to undergo a cornea transplant if the patient is willing. So we register them with the hospital, with the IBANC. So whenever we have a cornea with us, we check we grade the quality, and if it sits, if it matches the requirement with that particular patient, so then we call the patient and ask them to come for surgery.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, I think Dr. Rupali.
Hello, I can see Dr. Rupali. Yeah.
So I just wanted to respond to what Director Sir had said. So in this week itself, we have planned a session for the nurses and a quiz and a session on eye donation for our students as well. And as far as the donor list is concerned, we have the pledge forms, so they are there with us. So the relatives, whenever they call us, so we have a team ready to collect the donor eyes. In addition to that, we are regularly trying to meet the staff in the ICUs in our hospital and the trauma center so that, you know, in case there is a death where we can retrieve the corneas, we can do the counseling and get that cornea. So that is how we are maintaining our donor list.
And I would encourage nearby colleges, arts colleges and other places also we should visit. And NGOs should be involved. We have a lot of NGOs with us. They are helping us out in different projects. So if you tell them this facility is available, I am sure they will look for donors as well as recipient. It will be a big boost and help.
We have one session planned. We've called all our NGOs. So on 2nd of September, we have a session with the NGOs also to highlight this eye donation. So second, we have for NGOs, then for the nurses, and then for our medical students. But that's a very good idea. We can go to the colleges also nearby and get these pledges done.
And on CMC website also, can put a small caption where it is displayed. We are celebrating.
Yes, sir. Sir, I've shared that with Mr. Varun. I sent it to him, so he said he'll put it. So I've shared that with him already, sir.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Any more questions? Any?
Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Jain.
Yeah, so I think we need to work together as an institution for developing the organ transplantation program in various departments. And as a tertiary care center, we have all the infrastructure. Yes, it's very good corneal transplant we are doing. We need to reinitiate other transplant programs and it has to be a coordinated effort. I would say organ retrieval in South India, particularly Tamil Nadu. Recently I visited a hospital where almost all the transplants, whatever is being done globally, they are doing. And there is such an awareness about organ donation, not only cornea, but also other organs. So I think it's... CMC Ludhiana has led in this region many newer initiatives. Probably this is one area that we can do a comprehensive program in organ transplantation. Yeah.
Right. Thank you for those comments. Dr. William, any final thoughts or we wrap up for today?
Yeah, at the end I will say it's a good, excellent presentation, and we have to move forward and work together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next week we have Dr. Ashwin Phillips from the Department of Medical Oncology presenting the grand rounds. And the topic is metastasis, not the end of the road. So we would have Ashwin next week for the grand rounds. Thank you very much and have a great weekend. Thank you.